Pain signals are carried by E delta and C fibers of the primary neuron, which are activated through various noxious stimuli. Stimulations of nociceptors open voltage-gated sodium channels, allowing sodium ions to pass into the cell, causing depolarization. This gives rise to release of excitatory neurotransmitter from the nerve terminal, like glutamate and substance P. These neurons synapse with secondary neurons in the substantia gelatinosa of the dorsal horn of the spinal cord, which have NMDA and AMPA receptors. Binding of neurotransmitters to these receptors leads to opening of voltage-gated sodium channel and voltage-gated calcium channel, causing more and more action potentials to release. These neurons then crosses over to the other side of the spinal cord and ascends to the thalamus as the spinothalamic tract. It takes two pathways to the brain, through the paleospinothalamic tract and neospinothalamic tract. These neurons synapse with tertiary neurons in the thalamus and then travels to the somatosensory cortex. This is how the brain perceives the pain. In paleospinothalamic pathway, some fibers terminate in the hypothalamus, the periaqueductal gray matter of the midbrain, and the reticular nuclei of the medulla. From midbrain, the signals travel down as an interneuron, which synapses between the primary and secondary neurons at the spinal cord. These interneurons release endogenous opioids, such as enkephaline, and inhibits the transmission of pain signals. Enkephalines also allow opening of potassium channels, causing potassium efflux. The loss of positive charged ion from the cell leads to intracellular hyperpolarization, which in turn inhibits the action potential formation. So less pain signals are transmitted to the brain, so finally the pain is relieved. That's why endogenous opioids play a big role in body's pain-relieving mechanisms. Enkephalins also inhibits NMDA receptors. So it blocks binding of glutamate to NMDA, and thereby blocking the transmission of pain signals. Enkephalin also blocks voltage-gated calcium channel on the secondary neuron. So less calcium is entered into the cell, causing less depolarization and less action potential formation. Let's study the other factors causing endogenous opioids production. There are some nuclei in the brainstem called locus coeruleus in pons and locus raphe magnus in medulla. Neurons of locus coeruleus and locus raphe magnus release norepinephrine and serotonin respectively, which are the excitatory neurotransmitters. This activates the interneurons in the midbrain, causing further release of enkephalins, so it inhibits the pain signal transmission. After studying endogenous opioids, let's learn more about synthetic exogenous opioids. Synthetic opioids perform the same action as the endogenous opioids. They can also act on the opioid receptors, especially in the spinal cord, and also brainstem. There are three major types of opioid receptors, that is mu, kappa, and delta. These receptors are distributed in brain and spinal cord, as well as in the GI tract. And that's why activations of these receptors cause GI side effects such as nausea and vomiting. High doses of opioid drugs inhibit respiratory center in the brain, causing respiratory depression. This can cause hypoxic brain injury and even death. Drugs that can bind to all three opioid receptors are full agonists, and those which bind selectively at a specific receptor are partial agonists. An example of full agonist is morphine. Buprenorphine is an example of partial agonist. Norepinephrine and serotonin promotes endogenous opioids production. So antidepressants like SNRI, SSRI, and tricyclic antidepressants can relieve the pain by means of increasing excitatory neurotransmitters. Local anesthetics like lignocaine can reduce the pain by blocking the voltage-gated sodium channels. General anesthetics like ketamine reduce the pain by blocking the NMDA receptors. Gabapentin reduces the pain by blocking the voltage-gated calcium channel, and it is effective for treating neuropathic pain, where loss of voltage-gated calcium channels are upregulated. These are the medications used for pain relief, but there's more. Nociceptors are sensitized by pro-inflammatory mediators such as prostaglandin. When tissues are damaged, cell membrane phospholipids are converted to arachidonic acid. This activates cyclooxygenase and lipooxygenase pathways, from which the substances like prostaglandins and thromoxane A2 are produced. Most importantly, prostaglandins are produced. That's why NSAIDs such as aspirin that inhibit cyclooxygenase pathway can reduce the pain. Corticosteroids can also reduce the pain by blocking the conversion of phospholipids to arachidonic acid by phospholipase A2. The type of medication used to treat depends upon the severity of the pain. The cutoff points to determine mild, moderate, and severe pain are as follows. The range of 1 to 3 corresponds to mild pain, while scores between 4 to 6 represent moderate pain, and scores above 7 is considered as severe pain. WHO recommends using non-opioid analgesics like NSAIDs for mild pain, weak opioids for moderate pain, and strong opioids for severe pain. This three-step treatment recommended by WHO is also known as the analgesic ladder or pain ladder, which is a commonly used guideline for the management of pain. Recently, WHO has modified the pain ladder and a new step was added to it. Now it is revised into a four-step ladder. Interventional therapies are added in step 4, including invasive and minimally invasive procedures like nerve block and nerve ablation. This is the overview of the pain management. Pain can be treated through a variety of methods, including medications like analgesics, which are given in stepladder fashion. Management of severe chronic pain may require interventions such as destroying them with a chemical known as nerve block, or destroying with an electrical current known as nerve ablation. Rhizotomy is a surgical procedure to remove the nerve roots causing the pain. A spinal cord stimulator is a small device which is surgically placed under the skin that sends signals to the spinal cord and modify the pain signal from reaching to the brain. Physical methods like hot laser therapy or electrical therapies are another options to consider for pain management. Electrical therapies like transcutaneous electric nerve stimulation and transcranial direct current stimulation are emerging treatment methods. Doing physical exercises like yoga and tai chi are also effective at reducing pain. Patients may need psychosocial interventions like cognitive behavioral therapy, which focuses on treating the thoughts, beliefs, attitudes, and behaviors related to pain. Other therapies like hypnosis, meditations, and breathing exercises might help in pain reduction to some extent. That's all for now. Study hard and take care.